Hello and welcome to Controllers Tech. This is the 9th video in the STM32 UART series, and part 2 of the Lin Protocol. In the previous video we saw how to configure and program the master to send the data. We also analyzed the data using the logic analyzer, and saw the Lin Protocol frame in the analyzer. Today in this video we will connect an actual Lin transceiver to the MCU, and analyze the data sent by the master over the Lin bus. We will establish connection between two transceivers, and connect the slave to the second transceiver. We will also program the slave MCU, and extract the data from the receive frame. I am going to start with connecting a Lin transceiver module to the master MCU. I am going to use the MCP2004 Lin transceiver for it. Here is the datasheet of the transceiver. It supports a wide range of voltages from 6 volts to 27 volts DC. Here you can see the pinout for the transceiver IC. The RXD pin sends the UART data out to the MCU, so it connects to the UART RX pin of the MCU. The TXD pin receives the UART data from the MCU, so it connects to the UART TX pin of the MCU. The CS pin controls the transmitter part of the IC, and it connects to the output pin of the MCU. The TXE, or fault pin, is bidirectional, and allows disabling of the transmitter, as well as fault reporting related to disabling the transmitter. We will leave this pin disconnected. The VBB and VSS pins will be connected to the 12 volts power source. The VREN is the voltage regulator enable pin, and we will leave this pin disconnected. And finally we have the L bus, the Lin bus pin. This is where the data will be transmitted in the Lin protocol format. Here you can see the operational modes of the MCP2004. The IC is turned on when the voltage higher than 5.5 volts is provided. The receiver is on by default, and the transmitter is off. To turn on the transmitter, we need to set the CS pin high. Here you can see the connection diagram between the MCP2004 and the MCU. The TX pin from the IC should be connected to the TX pin of the MCU. The RX pin connects to the RX pin. We will connect the CS pin to the IO pin of the MCU, so that we can control the transmitter of the IC. Here you can see how the transceiver IC is connected to the MCU. On the right side we have the pinout for the IC. The pin 1 is the RX pin, and it is connected to the UART 1 RX pin on the MCU. Pin 4 is the TX pin, and it is connected to the UART 1 TX pin of the MCU. Pin 2 is the CS pin, and it is connected to the pin PC7 on the MCU. We will set this pin as output to control the chip transmitter. The pins 5 and 7 are the power supply pins, and they are connected to the 12 volts power supply. The pin number 6 is the Lin bus, I have connected it to the logic analyzer. The ground pin from the analyzer is connected to the ground of the power supply. Here I have the previous project, where we sent the data in the Lin format, but without using any transceiver. We need to add the CS pin to this project, so let's open the Cube MX. The pin PC7 will be used as the CS pin, so let's set it as the output. The UART configuration is the same as what we discussed in the previous video. I am enabling the interrupt, just in case the master wants to receive the data. Also, the break length should be 11 bits as per the Lin 2.1 standard. That is all, click Save to generate the project. I want the master to continuously send the data, so the transmitter should be always enabled. Here we will set the CS pin high to ensure that. The data is still the same that we sent in the previous tutorial. Let's build and flash the code to the board. The Lin bus is connected to the logic analyzer, so let's see if it recognizes the Lin frame. Here you can see the analyzer do read the frames every 1 second. Let's analyze it in detail. We have the break filed, followed by the sync field. Then we have the protected ID, 34 hex. After that we have 8 bytes of data, which is followed by the checksum byte in the end. So the transceiver is working fine, and the analyzer is able to detect the LIN frame on the LIN bus. Now I want to program the master so that it sends different data each time. Let's define an index variable, whose value will be used as the data. The index variable will increment after the previous value has been stored, and if the variable is more than 255, we will reset it back to 0. Alright, let's build and flash it to the board. Let's analyze a random frame. Here you can see the data with different values of the index variable. This particular frame has the data values from 24 to 31. The next frame has the data from 32 to 39. And the next one has it from 40 to 47. The checksum byte changes for each frame, because the data values are different. So our master is working fine, and the transceiver is able to transmit the data over the LIN bus. Now we will add one slave to this project. Let's create a new project. I am going to use the F103C8 for the slave device. Let's give some name to the project, and click Finish. Here you can see how the master and slave are connected via the transceivers. The LIN bus pin of the master transceiver is connected to the LIN bus pin of the slave. We have exactly the similar connection between the MCU and the transceiver. I am using the USART3 in the slave MCU, and the TX and RX pins are connected to the respective pins on the transceiver. The CS pin is the pin PB1. Let's set up the F103 MCU. We will start with the clock setup first. I am selecting an external crystal to provide the clock. The board has 8 MHz crystal on it, and we will run the MCU at maximum 72 MHz. Go to sysdebug, and enable serial wire. Now enable the USART3 in the LIN mode. The pins PB10 and PB11 are enabled by default, and we are using these pins for the connection. Let's set the pin PB1 as the output, so that it can be used as the CS pin. The board rate should be the same as what the master has, so set it to 9600. Go to the Interrupt tab, and enable the Global Interrupt. Now go to the GPIO settings, and enable the pull-up for the RX pin. This is very important, otherwise the slave will not receive the data. Alright, that is all the configuration we need, click Save to generate the project. We will copy the same code from the master project. We don't need the PID calculation for now, as the slave will not transmit the data. Instead of the TX data, let's rename it to RX data. The checksum calculation will be required, as we need to verify the received data. Note here that I am not setting the CS pin, instead it is low by default. I just enabled it to demonstrate that the CS pin is not needed to receive the data, it is only required for transmitting. Let's call the function receiveToIdle in the interrupt mode to receive 20 bytes of data. Now when all the 20 bytes are received, or an idle line is detected before that, an interrupt will trigger and the RX event callback will be called. Inside the callback we will call the same function, so that to make continuity in the reception. Let's build and debug the project. I have connected the master MCU to another computer, so that the IDE does not detect multiple SD links. Let me add the RX data to the live expression. Alright, let's run the debugger. You can see the data is being received in the RX data buffer. Let me change the mode to hexadecimal. We will analyze this data in detail, so let's see the analyzer. First we have the break field with all bits as low. This break field is detected as the byte 0 in the beginning. Then we have the sync field with the byte 55 hex, followed by the protected ID before hex. The actual ID is 34 hex. Here we have the sync filed 55 hex, and then the protected ID before hex. We can extract the actual ID from it, so we will write the code for the same. Then we have the 8 data bytes and the checksum byte at the end. Note here that the actual data starts from the third position, and the data length may vary depending on how many bytes the master is sending. We will write the slave program keeping that in mind. Let me take a screenshot of it, so that we can write the program according to this format. Alright, let's define a variable, numDataBytes, which will keep track of how many data bytes has been received. The variable ID will store the actual ID sent by the master. No matter how many data bytes are sent by the master, we will definitely have the first 3 bytes, and the last checksum byte. So we have 4 extra bytes in total. The size parameter of the callback stores the number of bytes received. So the data bytes will be equal to the size minus 4. This variable will confirm the validity of the received data. The actual data starts from the third position in the buffer. So we will once again calculate the checksum here. The protected ID is at the second position, and the data start from the offset of 3. The number of data bytes are already calculated. We know the checksum is the last byte in the buffer, so we will match the calculated checksum with the received checksum. If the checksum does not match, this means that the data is invalid, otherwise we have the valid data. The data buffer will store the actual data received. Inside the while loop, we will check if the data valid variable is set to 1. If it is, we will start copying the data from the third position in the RX buffer to our data buffer. Reset the variable so that this loop does not run again. Alright, let's build and debug the project now. Let's add the data buffer to the live expression. Alright, here you can see the data buffer contains the actual data extracted from the RX buffer. Let me change the display to decimal numbers. The data is being received every second, and you can clearly see the received data is according to how we programmed the master. We can also extract the actual ID from the protected ID field. To do so, we just need to extract the first 6 bits of the protected ID. Let's check it in the debugger. You can see the ID is 34 hex, and it is the same ID that the master sent. So everything is working well so far. We were able to program the slave device to receive the data from the Lin bus, and then extract the actual data bytes from the received data. We also made a successful connection between the 2 transceivers, and between the transceiver and the MCU. In the next tutorial, we will see more practical uses of the Lin communication, where the master will send the command to the slave device to perform various operations. This is it for this video. You can download the code from the link in the description. Leave comments in case of any doubt. Keep watching, and have a nice day ahead.